I ask you.
Right. Thank you. Mr. Xu, you're the next one. First, concerning the executive summary, point 14, with regard to the downtime, increase in downtime from 2012 to 2016 of the four major classes in terms of preventive maintenance, scheduling and running repair, the increase was 24.6%. From 6,000 odd days to 8,000 odd days. Why was it so? The director. Now please speak into the microphone. Sorry. Now in the report, table 9. If you may refer to table 9. And explanations were given. The major reason, I will not read them out. We agree to these reasons, and they have lengthened the preventive maintenance time, and therefore availability rate declined. Another point is that in 2016-17, the downtime was especially long. In particular, if you refer to Table 8, 2016, 4,518 days, that was the overall. 3,000 odd was budgeted downtime or forecast downtime. I've already explained that in 2016-17, I was given resources for preventive maintenance. We had more money for preventive maintenance in 2015-16. From $66 million, we were given a raise to $110 million. We did more preventive maintenance to ensure a more stable availability rate. We had more maintenance work. Works items increased from 135 to 195 in 2016. So the number of downtime, the availability rate was lower because of more maintenance. In Table 9, we have more orders, and therefore we were affected by more factors. The lower availability rate was not desirable. We should maintain the availability rate. Our target is 87, and the rate should not go under this. The actual rate should not go under this. We introduced a number of improvement measures to maintain that the usage availability rate is 87 or above. We have an inspection team. Even if the vessels are okay, we still conduct inspections as long as they frequently use or they are of a certain vintage. As for maintenance inspection, we have widened the scope of that. That is to conduct a thorough assessment. In Table 9, we spend 183 days on extra work not covered in service contract. The vessels are old. If we have adequate resources, we will dismantle the engine and look at everything. Now, if you just conduct an ordinary assessment, you may not be able to identify the defects. The contractors, the maintenance contractors, are very special. If we do not expect any problem with the electronics, and if we discover that there is such a problem, then we have to get another contractor. So we have expanded the scope of inspection before we have expanded the scope of pre-docking inspection. We can identify the problems beforehand, and there is more frequent meeting. There are more frequent meetings between different sections. We have better control of the docking time and also the time for waiting for spares. In the last session, the director referred to 2016-17 with regard to additional funding in the budget. But the report is between 2012 to 2016. So what's the relationship between this and the increase in budgeted funding in 2016-17? I refer to 2016-17 because of the following reasons. The major problem is that we have a budgeted downtime, but the time used or spent was more than the budgeted downtime. If we just look at the budgeted time downtime, then the availability rate is about 87%. But if the downtime is longer, then the availability rate will be lower. I therefore have to explain why the budgeted downtime was incorrect, why the downtime was longer. If you refer to Table 9, in 2016-17, it was especially long. The most incorrect estimate was in 2016-17. The reason was that we had to handle more orders. And that is also the issue of chronology. The budget was not correct. The budgeted time was not correct. We discussed with departments in January, early in the year. But funding is in April. When we have the money, then we roll forward the plan to consider how many more orders we can take. Table 9 is based on, or was based on, the budgeted downtime early in the year. So there is a discrepancy, and I feel the need to answer your question in this way. Chairman, if I may ask. Again, the director referred to 2016-17 with more funding, but I was referring to paragraph 14 between 2012 and 16. The increase in downtime, she said in A, that the increase was from 55 days to 400 odd days, so it's 7 times. Well, I was referring to the same thing. Mr. Xiu referred to the explanation for Table 9. Table 9 the second last paragraph, second last line, the extra downtime was longer, therefore availability rate was lower. That paragraph Mr. Xiu referred to was for the increase in 7 times from 55 to 457. The discrepancy was caused by the time difference in funding, and the further explanation for the subsequent or subsequent substantial increase with the additional funding. We had more money to handle the orders. The budgeted time was incorrect. The audit department mentioned the major reasons. Now, if we have had improvement measures, the impact of such reasons would be reduced. Say, for example, better coordination of the dogs, and then better assessment of the parts. If we don't need to wait for spare parts for a long time, then we can make improvements. So the explanation, my explanation is in relation to Table 9, and we introduce a number of improvement measures. This is Hugh, if I may help. In 2012, how many vessels belong to these four categories or four classes? And also the downtime increased substantially. Table 9, from 3 days to 95 days waiting for spare parts. The situation of the vessels vary. It's hard to compare if it is not a comparison between like with like. And that is aging of the vessels. And also bad weather. So you really can't help. As for dry dock facilities, dockyard facilities, from 3 days to 37 days, you have more vessels waiting to be repaired or maintained. Table 9, there are many reasons. Mr. Hsu want to ask you for the reasons. Waiting for spare parts. The vessels are old and you don't have the spare parts available. You can explain. Now from 55 days to 457 days, why is it so? Why was it so? You can explain the aging. How old are they? What conditions are they in? And also the availability of dry dock or dry dock spaces. You need to explain that as well. From 55 days to 457 days, so many things have happened. There must be a reason for that, and you are asked to give explanations to these reasons. Mrs. Hsu, I just want to help so that she can answer a question. Director, if I may refer to paragraph 14B, maybe let her answer the questions in relation to Table 9 first. Chairman, let me give you another attempt. Let me have another attempt to explain why more funding have caused the increase in downtime. I agree that all the reasons in Table 9 are the reasons for the extra downtime.
I'll give you a very simple example. Let's say only have three vessels available. Now we have five, and when a typhoon comes, then there will be more impact. So the reason of the higher number is because of more orders. For example, we have to wait for spare parts. Let's say I have to fix three vessels, and I'll need to wait for a certain period of time. But now, because we have more vessels, and therefore the waiting time would be even longer. Well, so that is because there's more fun. Well, this is not really an answer, because if you have more money, you see this problem. But then you need money to work on this. But if you don't have money, then you won't need to think of using the money. You know, there it seems that there is a need to use the money, am I right? I agree with what you said, Chairman. Well, I'm just trying to find the truth. The truth is that the vessels need maintenance. Therefore, I fight for more resources for funding. But even if I work on maintenance, if we don't have the spare parts, then there will still be extra downtime. For example, on the dock arrangement, sometimes it might delay the time. If I don't make improvements, then with more orders, that would have a huge impact. So first of all, because of more funding, these problems have aggravated, and therefore the downtime is longer. I have adopted many improvement measures, and I hope that in the future, with adequate resources, even with the increasing orders, I'll still be able to improve the issues listed out in Table 9. Some reasons, such as bad weather, could not be helped, but the waiting time for spare parts could be improved, and I would need to adopt many improvement measures to resolve the issue. So don't only focus on spare parts. I'm sure Mr. Lam will ask you questions about spare parts later. Mr. Shield, please continue. Oh, thank you. I'd like to go back to 14B on running repair. Usually there are two categories, right? One is regular maintenance, and the other B is a running repair. From what I see here, there are some circumstances when after maintenance, well, if there is no problem, then of course you would put it out to service again, but then there might be running repair cases. And there was a case mentioned here whereby high-speed craft sustained serious flooding of the engine within 2 months after receiving preventive service. So I want to ask about this. Do you think that you have not done enough in the maintenance issue? So this is case 3 on page 44 in the English version. Thank you, Chairman. 90% of the maintenance is done by the departments, and the main concern here is to survey the vessel after maintenance. Of course, we went to check whether maintenance has been done properly. There have been a few cases in which problems occur within a short period time after receiving preventive service. We need to find out if the maintenance service has been done properly. But sometimes after preventive service, incidents occur with other parts. So we could reflect on whether improvements can be made in the vessel surveillance after service. So we have now extended our surveillance of the vessels after service. We assess the maintenance companies. If there are problems arising after, then we would also take out points, because we do have a marking scheme for the maintenance teams. So we want the maintenance teams to be very complete in the checking of the vessels. So this is what we have done. Thank you. Well, I don't have a lot of time, so I will try to be brief. Paragraph 15 of the executive summary, the Audit Commission has pointed out that there are around 33 term contracts for maintenance, contract value of 29.1 million awarded by quotations. So if I understand correctly, it's not a tender. They just tell you how much they quote. And among the 33 term contracts, 23 of them, which is 70%, were each awarded to the only bidder. Does that mean 70% of them are sole bidders that only sent in a quotation? Well, we have a procedure for this. Less than 14.1 million, we would not need a tender. And yes, we award them by quotation. And we adopt a procedure under the FSTB. So every time we would need to invite five companies at least to tender or to quote. We would send out quotations via electronic devices. We do not receive many quotations, which we have also wondered why. There are certain maintenance services that cannot be done by all the maintenance companies. We are looking into reasons behind this because there is only limited competition. We have now invited the ICAC to help us to review our procedure. We are following procedures, but there have not been much competition in the procurement exercises. We have called up to the invited bidders yet who have not sent in quotations, and we've asked the reasons why, and very often the companies tell us that they did not send in tenders because they're already quite busy with other contracts, or that what needs to be done is not in their area of expertise. For example, they work on certain brand of machinery. If our vessels are of a different brand, they are not familiar with that and they're not willing to take up the work. So we have received these reasons from them. But it doesn't mean that these reasons take up 70%. Therefore, we have invited the ICAC to help us review our procedures to see where improvements can be made. Thank you. So the questions that I asked are related. First of all, there is high long downtime for the vessels for maintenance, mainly because of contracted out services. Look at the number, 70% are awarded to the only bidder. So that has nothing to do with inviting five companies because there is only one bidder. You have no choice. The director explained that there may be certain areas of expertise. Well, if that's the case, you should take note of what brand vessels you are buying. Is there only one company that can provide service? In my first question, I've already asked about the very long downtime, and I'm sure that these two are related. And then I'd like to go back to paragraph 10. You said there are frequent machine failure of two new vessels. Do these two new vessels come from the same company? Defer to Mr. Chen. Thank you, Chairman. The two new vessels come from the same batch and from the same company. So Would something be done to consider buying from this company in the future? Oh, thank you. When we choose vessels, we look at the international procedures, and if the vessels comply with all the tender requirements and with international procedures, then we would review the tender very carefully. Well, results show that there is machine failure in both vessels, so I think you really should be careful and be prudent when you are considering vessels from this company. All right, may I now move to paragraph 6? Oh, sorry, it's paragraph 5. Paragraph 5 in the executive summary, that from August 2013 to March 2017, some projects could not meet target dates of vessel delivery. That there is very slow progress in implementing vessel procurement projects. If you see from this paragraph, there have been delays in vessel delivery from 5 months to 4 years. Well, we understand that there have been delays in tenders, and the CTB was reviewing the process that, and that's why tender stopped for some time during the period. Well, we don't have the former director here today. Well, that's all right. You can still ask your questions. So when they found that there have been such long delays, did you actually try to reported that there have been such problems? Our chairman, we have reviewed our papers. There's a table in relation to the new vessels, but we see in our papers that we did report it to the dockyard and the marine department, but we did not find any follow-up in the papers. If you want to know whether the director has been made known of this information, we actually have not found information on whether any instructions have been given by the director. However, I would like members to understand that this would not occur again. Starting from 2014, all the internal meetings have been recorded. And from 2016, I myself and Mr. Freely Cheng go down frequently to the docks to join in their senior management meetings. And we have made the weekly meeting report a must. And Mr. Cheng has to report to me on what has been discussed in the meeting. So we have enhanced supervision and management. Well, thank you for your explanation. If you recall, I've asked you to submit information on what has been done in the past 3 years, and then we will follow up later. Thank you. Thank you, Chairman. It's very difficult in recruitment, I understand. And average age is around 50 years old. If you do not import people from outside, it's very difficult to find the appropriate people to work in this area. Have you tried to recruit people from overseas? Well, we have to look at value for money. Have you tried to conduct recruitment exercise overseas since the starting pay point is very high with housing subsidy in the first year as well?
Mr. Chang.
In recent years, due to the difficulty in recruitment, we have applied to the CSB to try to expand the scope of recruitment. And we have considered adding a few points on the master pay scale. And another measure is that the SOS entry requirement is very strict, and you need the certificate of competence class 1, and also to receive a charter accreditation and at least a few years of experience. We have asked the CSB whether this could be relaxed, that even if and with a class 1 certificate and no experience, could we at least first hire them at a lower starting point? We have also requested the requirement on language proficiency. So that there would be more people who can be who are suitable for the position. We have also relaxed the Chinese language proficiency for overseas candidates, because some positions do not require the use of Chinese. We have made offer to foreign candidates before, but they decided not to come. Well, Mr. Xu's question is whether you have conducted such recruitment overseas. Well, I understand local recruitment, but have you done any overseas recruitment? Well, can you please be quick, because I have to attend another meeting. Well, if yes, you know, then you know that's the end of my question. If you don't do any, or you don't conduct any overseas recruitment, then it's okay. Please consider. Well, but well, right now we need a Hong Kong permanent resident to apply for these jobs. Well, can you contract out such positions? Because if you cannot find suitable people in Hong Kong, well, that's all right. I mean, if you increase the pay, but the problem is right now you cannot find any suitable candidates. Oh, I'm sorry, you know, I'm rushing to a meeting. Oh, this is only my suggestion. Please consider. Well, yes, your comments have been taken into consideration. And very quickly, I would like to ask Director. You said vessels can be used for a longer period of time with good maintenance. In your table, you've listed out some 15 years, 20 years for the different categories. So this is only an estimation, but as you said, you can use it for a longer time if you can maintain it well. So for these vessels, how many years more can you use? And how can you extend the expected lifespan? Our director, you have answered this in earlier. Well, I cannot give you a specific answer because each type is different. Even if you use steel for both vessels, the lifespan may be different. It depends on how often or how frequent you use it, much like cars. The more the miles, the shorter the lifespan. And this will be different for each vessel. Therefore, we have to ensure that there is frequent maintenance, and then to ensure that when these vessels should be retired.
Will you have a report for every vessel for vetting, saying that its lifespan can be extended, etc.? Do you have a report? Well, it's very difficult. There are 848 vessels. If you seek a report for every vessel, oh, so I don't need it. No, I don't need it. I'm talking about internal reports. Because supposedly every vessel is monitored by somebody. You would monitor the engine and the hull to see whether it works. I'm just asking you whether you have an internal report. If yes, then you should know. You should know whether a vessel can have a longer lifespan, but you don't need to answer me. I have a time constraint myself. Last but not least, I'd just like to say that the vessels are a kind of a professional subject for members of the public, even for members of the council. But Mr. Stephen Ho may know a little more. But the department, you should not treat this lightly. If we can't supervise you, you should get professionals to supervise you. We mentioned the marine disaster, and that is about all these problems. We don't understand them, and you need professionals to watch over this. The administration has got the budget for you, but if you can't recruit people and supervise the situation, that is not ideal. You have to be serious. If you can't recruit locally, look overseas. If it is just a story on a building, in a building, the FSD will check it, and then people may know that there is a fire risk. But we don't understand vessels. We depend on you, so please treat this seriously. Undersecretary, you need to answer this question because this is about safety. A comment has been expressed, and this has to do with vessel safety in Hong Kong. Please answer the question. Do you think there is a problem or there is no problem? Or if there is a big problem? Of course, safety is always our utmost concern. We will adhere to our safety guidelines and we would regularly update laws and regulations. Director, Chairman, just like to make one point. We were talking about outsourcing and recruiting overseas. We need to talk to the CSB about the policy. But we are also actively outsourcing our service. I said 9 international classification societies are present in Hong Kong, and a lot of the surveying work has been outsourced to them. The PAC does not look at policies, but we have a responsibility to look at things from a value for money angle, and you need to answer questions. But if there are policy issues, we will refer them back to the panels. Next, Mr. Kenneth Leung. Before you go to another point, can you allow Mr. Lam Chek Ting to follow up on 2 issues? Well, of course, but actually I know Mr. Shiu Ka Fai's question has already gone to part 3, but after Mr. Lam Chek Ting has asked questions on part 2, I still also have questions on part 2 before I go to part 3. Mr. Shiu Ka Fai has been switching from one topic to another because he has to attend another meeting. We will always allow officials to answer questions whenever we ask them, especially those on safety. We can't leave question marks there. I will not allow that to happen. Mr. Lam Chek Ting, please carry on with your questions. Thank you, Chairman. If I may refer to Para 2.14, we were talking about the controversy about the scoring system and that delay things for 3 years. In Para 2.14, it says, in September 2010, the GNCS reported that the revised marking scheme was expected to be approved by the CTB in February 2011. While the expected approval date of the revised marking scheme was subsequently not met, there was no record showing reporting discussion at the management meetings on the likely impact. For example, the number of procurement projects affected and the extent of delays and any possible measures to mitigate the impact, such as reassessing the need for using marking schemes for the pending procurement projects. Chairman, I'd like to ask the director. At that time, was it a break in the communication chain within the department. It is said here that the management does not have any records showing that it received reports to say that the delay in revising the marking scheme was going to affect the procurement projects. So was there a problem with internal communication? I think you mentioned that in 2016 you took up a reform, but please comment on the question. Thank you, Chairman. In May 2013, the TH Bureau set up the Steering Committee on Systemic Reform in the Marine Department, and it showed that there were different management problems within the MD. The Steering Committee directed that there should be a reform, and that is about work culture and management culture, and also communication within the department, and also, lastly, record keeping. After 2013, there has been reform in internal governance to target these four aspects. And I can tell you now that, as I said, management-wise, I personally have management meetings with different divisions and sections. We have weekly meetings to look into the issues in every unit, and we keep all the records. Director, you have already explained this. Mr. Lam was asking you a question on 2.14, and that is communication in those 3 years. You have been talking about post-2013, but please comment on the question asked. Yes, that is why I'm saying the reform was targeted at the problem. So you admit that there was a problem. Yes, but why was there a problem? We are a fact-finding exercise here. You have carried out the reform, but it doesn't mean that the problem was not there. We are here to get at the facts, and it's not just your department. Or perhaps I can rephrase my question this way. Well, actually, your question was clear, and she has to answer. All right? Let me try again. In 2013, before we had the reform, well, as reflected by this, there was a very lax management culture. Records were incomprehensive. Say, for example, the audit came to do this audit, and it asked us to dig up records, but we couldn't find them. It's not that we didn't want to, but there were no such records. And we did not see records of meetings on internal communication. So it reflected that there was inadequate communication. I could see from the available documents of that time that in terms of record keeping and management culture, there have been inadequacies, as pointed out by Mr. Lam Chek Ting. You know, all this will go into our report. You have to explain this to us. Understand, Chairman, if I may refer to Paris 2.14 and 2.15, apart from what I read out, that there was no record to show that the management received any reports on the effect of the marking scheme. Secondly, it also said that there was no record to show that the MD responded to the DOJ's proposal to revise the marking scheme. And thirdly, in 2.15, it is said that the MD did not keep any records of its senior management's monitoring of the GNCS's work on reviewing the marking scheme from 2010 to 2012. It seems management in those years at the MD almost collapsed. Well, you ask them. This is unimaginable. One of your main duties is to watch over the maintenance and repair of government vessels and also replacement. And yet, you stopped for 3 years That is abnormal. There should have been an existing system, even if you did not have the new system. You spent a few years on formulating the new system, but then it seems everything ground to a halt in those 3 years. Can I give the opportunity for them to answer the question? Well, unimaginable. Things were so bad internally. There are no records even when we want to get at the heart of the matter. I think there is a serious problem with internal management of the MD. The director has already said how they improved, but the undersecretary, can you answer the question? We admit that there have been inadequacies, especially in management culture. Please speak up. We admit that we have not been doing well in terms of work culture, management culture, and communication, and also record management, as Mr. Lam talked about. Therefore, in May 2013, we set up the steering committee in order to take a look at the problem, and we submitted the report in April 2016. We admitted that we did not do a good job. We thank you for admitting so honestly. Can you show us papers how you admitted to this, how you sought an understanding into the matter so that you set up the steering committee? It will be difficult for you to explain here, but please dig up papers. Mr. Chairman, yes, continue. I will ask one more question. Just now, Mr. Xiu Ka-fai referred to page 28 about the frequent mechanical failure of two new vessels. Mr. Xiu asked whether the two vessels were built by the same builder. You said yes. You call them sister vessels, right? And then he asked whether you would do anything about this supplier in future tendering exercise. Mr. Chen of the MD said that they would adopt an open approach in doing the vetting. I want the director to tell us more. If a vessel builder received over $10 million to build two vessels, and yet within a short time or within the warranty period, there have been frequent breakdowns affecting the operation of the entire vessels. Can you just say you will continue to conduct tendering exercises in an open and fair manner? Would you blacklist the builder? Director, two questions. One about tendering and vetting. Two, frequent failures within a short period of time. Did you look into compensation and relevant matters? Because we are doing a value for money study here. I will answer the first question, the tendering issue. I agree with Mr. Lam that we, of course, are concerned about the tendering procedures. But in the tendering system, we do not have a demerit point system and we do not have a blacklist. Can we do it? We need to talk to the two supplies officers who have been seconded to our department. I understand there is a demerit point system for large-scale procurement, but we have never had it for vessel purchase or procurement. Therefore, we need to look into whether we should have a demerit point system. I can respond to this point, please. Chairman, allow me. Well, this is quite unimaginable. The housing department and other government departments do this if the contractors or suppliers commit major faults. These will be stopped from tendering for a period of time. This is nothing new for government. Why is it that it's like a new discovery to you? Why do you still have to look into it? This is a time-honored system. Well, this is a policy issue. The undersecretaries should answer. At the Housing Authority, you have seen contractors who did not deliver and they would be debarred from joining tendering exercises. Will you look at the Marine Department from the same angle? This is about supervision. Thank you, Chairman. That is correct. The HA does have a system to supervise contractors. If they don't do a good job, they will be subject to a demerit point system. Some may even be debarred from putting in a tender for a period of time. In para 2.36 of the report, the audit says we should review the situation to prevent a recurrence of the problem. And in the response from the government in 2.37, we said we agree with the audit recommendations. Secretary, this is a big problem. Mr. Leung also talked about failed supervision. How do you communicate with the departments? Because you have it for one department and not have it for another department. The PAC has seen the same problem about tendering, for example, with regard to CAD. It is up to you to formulate a uniform policy. Thank you for that reminder, Chairman. Last word from me, Chairman. I'd like the Bureau or the Department to respond to this. Suppliers may not supply goods according to the specifications, and if you don't put them in a blacklist and you allow them to continue to take part in tendering exercises and there is no demerit point system, does it amount to encouraging them to supply you with substandard goods? Well, they have already accepted the recommendations of the audit in 2.37. They have said they accept the recommendation. But I find this very outrageous, and this is against common sense. But they have already accepted that point. Director, you'd like to answer the second question? Maybe I can add to the last one first. Whether or not there is a demerit point system, we have it for maintenance. We just don't have it for procurement. In principle, we will not object to this. We believe there is a need for this. Why I am saying I need to talk to the supplies or procurement officers is because most of the contracts for procurement vessels are subject to government procurement under World Trade Organization. Okay, don't talk about this again. Time is short. You have promised that you will do it, so do it. Of course, there are WTO rules. Doesn't the HA have to follow WTO procurement rules as well? But you have already said you would do it, so you don't need to explain anymore. Just answer question number two.
Within the period of time specified, how are you going to seek compensation for these two new vessels? Mr. Chan, or who will answer the question? Concerning the problems of the two vessels, we have lengthened the warranty period. Who is to foot the bill? That's from the value for money perspective. Maintenance of those defects within such a short period of time, they should have a plan to deal with that. If they have not done that, then you can claim them. Have you made any claims against them, or you just couldn't care less? You just say you are forward-looking, and you will not bar them from making further bids. Now, during the warranty period, all the replacement of the parts and all the defects will rectification will be paid for or are paid for by the supplier. And we have already ordered the necessary parts. So now can you confirm this? With these defects, the government have not paid, the government has not paid a dollar for rectifying the defects. Give us a document or write up a paper to answer this. We don't want to make life difficult for you, but you do need to provide the documents. Where were those vessels made? Well, just give us a paper to answer that. Give us a paper to answer that, Mr. Chen. You don't need to answer the question offhand if you don't have the information now. I have a question, a follow-up to Mr. Xiu's question with regard to case 3, the high-speed boat. Now you maintain the boat for, or repair the boat for 3 months, and there is still water leakage. Now can you provide a paper on that? We are still doing the investigation. If there is an investigation report, and we will give you a report. Give you the report. Yes, please. Yes, Kenneth. I think we have about 35 minutes. I want to wrap up part 2. And then I know that Mr. Ho also has some questions on part 2. I will not spend too much time. In part 2, I still have 2 questions. I like those tender exercises. I want to look at I want you to look at Appendix C. If you look at the table, the chronology. Now, in circular number 8 by the FSTB, August 2014, one shouldn't rely too much on the marking scheme. That's the circular memorandum. Can we have a copy of the memorandum? The director? Yes, you will give the memorandum to us. Yes, indeed. Now, after August 2014, the tendering exercise will be done in this way. There is a technical specification. The bidders will have to meet the basic technical criteria before they can be accepted to bid. Say they will have to show you how many years of experience and how good they can meet your requirements. If you are to construct a vessel and A and B are able to meet the basic requirements, then after confirming that A and B can meet the requirements, you will not consider the technical merits anymore. You just look at the price. Chairman, now you know the experience of the CAD. ABC companies comply with the minimum or basic requirements. And then you ignore that above the basic requirements, ABC companies have different technical merits. Do you look at the technical merits above the minimum? Or you just look at the minimum and then you look at the price? And then you will choose the company that provides the lowest price. That offers the lowest price. So can you tell us what is the weighting? 60, 40, 70, 30? Or you have a two envelope system and you just look at the basic technical requirement And then afterwards, you will look at the the financial aspect. Now, we will not use the new marking scheme whenever if it is not necessary. So we look at the in the assessment process, we look at the companies whether they meet the necessary conditions. If they fulfill the necessary conditions, then we will consider the technical requirements. The technical requirements are more detailed than the necessary requirements. If they can meet the technical requirements, then they will be in. And then we look at the price. Without the marking scheme, we cannot give any score. A marking scheme is to give marks to the bidders in respect of various factors and aspects. Now we look at the technical aspects first, and if they pass, then we look at the price. No one can answer this question here. I think it's a question for the FSTB. And I asked our clerk to issue a letter to the CTB or the FSTB. I want to know the overall procurement strategy of the administration. Do you adopt a marking scheme, or you have a general direction? Buying different things requires different specifications. Now, the computer system, the aviation control system, there is the technical element and there is the price element. If you say there is no marking scheme, you just adopt a qualitative assessment. But that is still an assessment. Different colleagues have different interpretation of the matter. Now, Carol, can you explain to us what is your policy? The Marine Department is rather special, but Mr. Leung has asked a general question. What is your policy? Just set aside the Marine Department. According to the procurement rules and regulations, if the user department procures certain product or service, if quality is important, then we still hope that they can have a marking scheme. In 2014, we issued a circular memorandum asking the departments to avoid excessive use of marking scheme because we identified that certain departments have a very long and marking scheme, and that has lengthened the tendering process and may deter smaller companies from bidding for government contracts. So we just remind them to try so that they can avoid excessive use of the marking scheme, and if they do want to use a marking scheme, the marking scheme should be precise and concise. It's not that we rule out a marking scheme. If quality is important, a marking scheme should be used, but the marking scheme should not be too long and too complicated. Yes, I understand your point. Quality is important. Say, for example, high-tech products, high-end products require very detailed specifications. Unlike buying pencils and rubber. With regard to the quality of boats, of our vessels, do you think they are important? Do you think quality is important or primary? And I don't know whether there is any good communication between the FSTB and the memorandum and the Marine Department in respect of the memorandum. When the FSTB issued the memorandum, different departments had different interpretations of the memorandum. As a result, different departments and bureaus had different procurement policies. I don't think that's the original intention of the FSTB. I want to hear from the Director of Marine on the view on quality of vessels in the procurement. I think it's not, one should not question about the interpretation of the circular 82014. In fact, the circular is to give flexibility to the departments to deal with tendering or to deal with procurement in a fair and flexible manner. We don't need to pursue a question on the memorandum, but we should ask the Marine Department on how they look at it. They also serve different departments, the fire services, the police, and they do have requirements and specifications in respect of the vessels. How do you work under 8-2014? After August 2014, we follow the comply with the spirit of the memorandum. We will not resort to the marking scheme if it is not necessary. The necessary requirements and the technical assessment requirements can be put into the contract, and quality is important as far as the products are concerned. If the present approach cannot meet the requirements, then we can still resort to the marking scheme. It really depends on the types of vessels required. If the specification of the vessels are not very complicated, then we can do away with marking scheme. Well, other departments are also involved in the procurement, right? Now you have user departments. And you also have, yes, we work very closely with the user departments, in particular with regard to the technical requirements, and the supplies officers are fully involved in the process. I want to refer to a case in part 2. In table 3, the delivery date has been delayed very substantially. Number 3, a fireboat. In 1990, the fireboat was in service since 1990. The expected lifespan is 15 years. So by 2005, it reached the end of its lifespan, expected lifespan. But in 2012, $85,000 were given. Yet, the matter was dragged on, and tender evaluation was in progress, and the contract was awarded in 2015. From 2005 to 2017, 12 years had elapsed, and the fireboat had not been delivered. Now, it's about human life. And the fireboat is used to save lives and protect property. Can you explain to me the details? In fact, the two fireboats mentioned in detail in the audit Commission's report on the FSD. we didn't share our responsibility. Now in 2010 to 2013, the procurement was very slow. And there was also the problem that in 2011, because of the Fukushima incident, the fire services discovered that the specifications had to be substantially revised so that the fireboat could be equipped to deal with biochemical contamination. The technical specifications were substantially revised. Such details were also listed in report number 67. But you did not explain. Mr. Leung asked that in 2012 you fully knew the specifications of the fireboat and therefore you had the number $85 million. It wasn't that you were given $85 million that they decided on how to spend the $85 million. When we made the approval, we fully knew what we were going to buy. Why in 2012 you asked $85 million? What was included in the under the $85 million? And only in November 2017 the contract was awarded. In PAC report 67, number 67, you said it was mentioned in detail. We would dig into that again. What happened from 2012 to 2017? You need to explain that to us. If you can't do it now, you can submit a paper to explain that. Chairman, let me explain. Let me attempt to answer the question. Chairman is right. When the FC approved the funding of $85 million, we move on to the pre-tender preparation. And in order to draw up a tender document, we need to draw up the detailed technical specifications. In discussing the technical specifications, we spend a lot of time with FSD to translate high-level technical requirements to details in the tender document, and that required a lot of time. Nuclear, biological, and chemical contamination was something new, and we had to discuss in detail of the technical requirements. Mr. Cheng, in 2012, when you came before us, you asked for $85 million. You told this council that in 2014, the boat will be delivered and will be used. The boat that came, started its service, the boat started its service in 1990. That's about protection of life and limb and property. You say it was very complicated, but there were 4 years between. So did you hide anything from the LegCo? A lot of documents, legal documents were involved, and there were promises. Now the PAC, we take your word for it. Now we have good memories. I was there in 2012.
Don't just rush in your answer. Just tell us the truth. We are not trying to trick you. I want to be fair to you. Because maybe you weren't there at the time, can you go back and take a look at the papers and supply us with additional information? Chairman, I understand what you said about the nuclear biotechnological requirements you need, but how long do you need to discuss this for? And you gave LegCo a pledge that it would, that you'll be able to deliver in 2014. I'm sure that you knew of this technological requirement. So I think you should submit more thorough information to us. We don't want to criticize you right now because you might not have known what happened. Well, although you have the responsibility to answer, you need to tell us the truth. Kenneth, I'd like to now defer to Mr. Ho for further questions. Thank you. We have to be fair to the Marine Department. Well, we are very fair. The public may think that we are targeting the Marine Department, but no, actually the fire services also bear responsibility because of the inadequate communication system. Therefore, the FS also needs to bear responsibility. The approved funding of the $85 million for the fourth generation system, we, from the paper, believe that it should be set up, and we thought that delivery would be 2014. Therefore, we cannot accept this. So please be careful when you are preparing papers for LegCo. This is THB's responsibility. You cannot just blame it on the Marine Department. You also have to submit to us a feasibility report. Well, we haven't even started on the cases yet, but I'm sure you have already prepared to answer our questions. I see from the many audit reports that the two cases should not be brought up here because they were very, very simple, basic mistakes. Well, you said discrepancies were found, but you're not talking about major technical issues, that there has been a discrepancy in requirements. You're just talking about discrepancy between the tender invitation and the gazetted information. So we have to go back to ABC of the paper. We need to look into what should be done by the Marine Department. So does the government bear the responsibility to look at what is gazetted and what is in the invitation of the tender? Maybe the government didn't check before completing a report. Maybe the GNCS informed that the tender information does not comply with the regulations. So the government is responsible for making sure that the information is not wrong. We have now given you money and funding to recruit more people. Is it because of a lack of manpower that such a simple mistake was made because you could not have someone to monitor the situation? Mr. Cheng, please. Well, we have to be fair. Your department provides different services from other departments. Therefore, when you write up these papers, you have to explain to us how you communicate with the other departments to come up with this mistake in your tender. We don't want you to have to take all the blame. Mr. Chen, please. Thank you. For these two cases, there was a mistake made. Therefore, the information was different from the Gazette and from the tender invitation. Therefore, after seeking advice of the DOJ, we decided that it would affect the fairness of the tender, and therefore we had to take it back, and then we invite tender. We admit that it was a neglect on our part. Therefore, we now have two teams of people to cross-check to make sure that this kind of sort of low-tech mistake would not be made again. We have accumulated many tenders not yet released, and if we need to re-tender, the process would be even longer, thus affecting the final delivery date of the vessels. Chairman, I believe in 1.7b, it's not only the problem of the government. You would also talk to the consultants. So when you talk to the government, do you have the responsibility to make sure that all the tender documents are correct, or would the official just delegate authority to the consultant for the information? I'm not even talking about how much money you are wasting because of the delay in project. I'm talking about that with a delay in tendering, there is a more cost in various departments, such as extending the lifespan of old vessels and maybe court cases. That increases the risk on the community. So I'd like to ask about the distribution of work under 1.7b. Well, I think it's better for you to submit information later on, because the government cannot delegate authority to the consultant. The consultant is only there to assist you. So please be very careful in your answer. Yes, the government can contract out services, not contract out responsibility. All right, so please come back with the information later on. All right, if she's unable to give you an answer right now, well, you know, it's difficult for them to answer today because they still have to go back to read the papers. Well, I don't want them to give an answer right now because they might give an inaccurate answer. All right. After listening to Mr. Leung's question, I would like the government to provide more information on the understanding of the marking scheme 2.14, and the FSTB felt that the marking scheme paper was over long and over complicated, and it should be briefer. But from what I heard from the MD, it seems that they didn't want to use it. So I want to ask the whether a couple of examples could be given by the FSTB on the complicated marking scheme. How about you tell us about the paper from August 2014? Thank you, Chairman. We're willing to provide information on the marking scheme later on. When we issued the circular, on the memorandum number 82114, we reminded bureaus and departments to avoid excessive use of marking scheme, because at that time we noticed that some marking scheme assessment was long and complicated and overly detailed, delaying the entire tender process and maybe deterring new companies who are interested in tendering. Therefore, that was why we issued the Memorandum 8214. Then, well, if you try not to use it, then when do you use the marking scheme? I don't quite understand. Chairman, well, after the circular was issued, we tried our best to avoid use of the marking scheme unless the tender could not be completed without a marking scheme. Otherwise, we would only use the two parts that I have mentioned just to comply with the requirements and the technical requirements to invite tender. So this is the method we're adopting right now. I want to ask about the 8/2014. Was that before the reform, or was that after? Because if that was after the systematic reform and you have all the information, could you submit us with the additional information on how you view circular number 8/2014? It seems that the FSTB's meaning is if you want to use it, then you have to make it simple. But the Marine Department's view is that they try to evade from using. Do you have the information on whether you have used the marking scheme in the past 2 years? I mean, if it does not relate to any sensitive information, could you give us with the information? We want to see how you use it. All right, yes, if you do have such information, please give it to us, and also tell us how you understand Circular 8/2014. All right. After you receive the Circular 8/2014, you might issue a memo to your colleagues with some sort of information, or did you hold a meeting to explain the circular? I want this information if you have it. And we also want to know who was responsible for drafting the document, from which department, from which grade, who was responsible for the tender gathering. We did this with the CAD previously too. Please provide us with that information. All right, we only have 5 more minutes. Kenneth, do you want to hold another meeting, or what do you wish to do? Yes, I believe we need another meeting because we haven't asked about the questions on maintenance and control. Yes, I think many colleagues still have questions. How about we conclude Chapter 2, and then we see what else needs to be followed, and then we continue with Chapter 3 and 4. Yes, Mr. Xiu already asked some questions on Chapter 3, so we would invite you back for our next meeting. And thank you. And please submit us with the information we want as soon as possible, and please study those before you come up to the PAC. Thank you.
Thank you.